I'm Alan Roberts, welcoming you to the fifth and final segment of Math Made Easy Geometry. Today, my co-host, Vanessa Stewart, and I will focus on circles.
First, we'll explain what a circle is. Then we'll tell you about the lines that are associated with a circle and about the angles that are associated with a circle. Finally, we'll discuss the area and circumference of a circle. The first thing we want to do is to draw a circle. This tool is called a compass. Let us place its point on a sheet of paper and draw a figure all the way around. The figure that comes out is a circle. The point of the compass is at the center of a circle.
All of the points that we drew are at the same distance from the center of the circle. That distance is called the radius of the circle. The letter R is usually used to designate the length of the radius. How long is the radius of this circle?
The radius of this circle is the distance from the center to any point on the circle, which is 5.
You should remember the words center and radius. We plan to refer to them in this entire tape. The plural of the word radius is radii. Another important word to know is the diameter. A diameter is a line segment that connects two points on the circle and that passes through the center. A diameter contains two radii. The letter D is usually used to designate the length of the diameter. How long is the diameter of this circle?
The radius is 5 and the diameter is 10. There are several other lines that are associated with circles, and you should know their names. A chord is any line segment between two points on the circle. If the chord passes through the center of the circle, then that chord is a diameter.
Is a diameter a chord?
Yes, every diameter is automatically a chord. A diameter is the longest possible chord. Some chords are diameters, but some chords are not diameters.
If we extend a chord in both directions, we have a line that intersects the circle in two points. We call that a secant line. A line that touches the circle in exactly one point is called a tangent line. To review, what is this line?
This line segment between two points of the circle is a chord.
What is the special name for this chord that goes through the center of the circle?
It is a diameter.
What is the name of this line?
The line that touches the circle exactly once is called a tangent line.
What is the name of this line?
The name of the line that intersects the circle in two points is a secant.
Good. Now that we know some of the vocabulary, we can explain some theorems about the lines that are associated with a circle. First, a few facts about tangent lines. A radius that touches the circle at the point of tangency must be perpendicular to that tangent. And conversely, if a line is perpendicular to the end of the radius, then that line must be tangent to the circle. Here's a problem for you. In this figure, OA is a radius of a circle. The length of OA is 3. A tangent is drawn from A to the point P, and the length of AP is 4. What is the length of segment OP?
To answer this question, we are going to use the theorem that we just learned and also something that we learned in an earlier videotape about triangles. The theorem that we just learned states that the radius OA is perpendicular to the tangent AP. Therefore, triangle OAP is a right triangle. And we can use the Pythagorean theorem. OP is the hypotenuse of our right triangle. So the length of OP squared equals the length of OA squared plus AP squared. That is equal to 3 squared plus 4 squared, which is 9 plus 16, which equals 25. So OP equals the square root of 25, giving us the answer 5.
Another fact about tangents has to do with the two tangents that are drawn to a circle from a point that is outside of the circle. Those two tangent segments are equal. In this figure, AQ and BQ must be equal. What can you say about the quadrilateral OAQB?
Well, we just said that AQ equals BQ. The two remaining sides, OA and OB, are both radii, so OA equals OB. This quadrilateral is in the shape of a kite.
In summary, what have we learned about tangent lines? We've learned that a line is tangent to a circle if and only if it is perpendicular to the radius at the point of tangency. And we've learned that tangent segments from the same exterior point are equal.
Now, a couple of facts about chords. In this figure, the chords AB and CD intersect inside of the circle at point P. There is a theorem that states that the product of the lengths of the segments on one chord must equal the product of the length of the segments on the second chord. In our figure, that means that AP times PB must equal CP times PD. We're not going to prove this, but let's just mention a method of proof. We can prove it by showing that triangle APC is similar to triangle BPD. As an example, given that AP equals 10, PB equals 20, and CP equals 5, how long is PD?
AP times PB equals CP times PD. That makes 10 times 20 equal to 5 times PD. 5 times PD equals 200, and PD equals 40.
The two chords that we have drawn can be of any angle to each other. Another theorem about chords is that if a diameter is drawn perpendicular to a chord, then that diameter bisects the other chord.
Here's an example. In this figure, AB is a diameter passing through the center O of the circle. It is perpendicular to the other chord, CD, at the point P. Our theorem states that CP must equal PD.
Good. We have learned some facts about tangents and about chords. Is there anything that you can say about secants?
Yes, there are some theorems about the lengths of secants. Let's draw two secants from a point outside of a circle. In this figure, PAB and PCD are secants. There is a theorem that states that the product of one secant and its external segment is equal to the product of the second secant and its external segment. In our figure, that means that the secant PAB times the external segment PA equals the product of secant PCD times the external segment PC.
Suppose PA equals 3, PB equals 8, and PC equals 2. What is the length of PD?
3 times 8 equals 2 times PD. 24 equals 2 times PD. So PD equals 12.
Here is one final theorem about the line segments that are associated with a circle. If a secant and a tangent are drawn from an exterior point, then the square of the tangent equals the product of the lengths of the secant and the length of the secant's external segment. In this figure, that means that PA squared equals PB times PC. That concludes our review of theorems about chords, tangents, and secants.
Now we're about to discuss circles from the viewpoint of coordinate geometry. Let's go back to the first circle that we described. That circle has its center at 0, 0 and a radius of 5. Let's find the equation of this circle. We're looking for an equation that is satisfied by every point that is at a distance of 5 from the center.
Remember the distance formula. The distance between any two points is equal to the square root of x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. Given any point xy on the circle, we want the distance between that point and the origin 0, 0. Substituting into the formula, we have the square root of x minus 0 squared plus y minus 0 squared, which equals the square root of x squared plus y squared. That has to equal 5. Squaring both sides gives us the equation of x squared plus y squared equals 25.
In this particular case, we found the equation of the circle with center at 0, 0. The same method can be used to to find the equation of any circle wherever on the coordinate plane its center is, and no matter what its radius is. Consider the circle with center at the point HK and with radius R. Substituting into the formula for the distance between two points, we have the square root of x minus h squared plus y minus k squared. That has to equal r. Squaring both sides, we obtain the equation x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared.
Here is an exercise in using this formula. Find the equation of the circle with the center at point 2, 3 and with radius 7. Press the pause button while you write the equation.
Substituting into our formula, where h is 2 and k is 3, we have x minus 2 squared plus y minus 3 squared equals 7 squared, or 49.
We will now talk about the various angles that are associated with circles.
A central angle of a circle is an angle whose vertex is at the center of the circle. Each of the two sides of a central angle is a radius of the circle. They cut the circle into two points. In this example, angle AOB is a central angle. Its vertex is at the center O, and its sides cut the circle at points A and B.
This central angle cuts the circle into two portions. We show the smaller portion in green and the larger portion in blue. The smaller portion is called a minor arc, and the larger portion is called a major arc.
Remember that an angle is measured in degrees. A right angle contains 90 degrees, a straight angle contains 180 degrees, and all the way around is 360 degrees.
Arcs of a circle are also measured in degrees. We define the number of degrees in an arc by saying that minor arc AB has the same number of degrees as the central angle AOB.
If angle AOB is a right angle, how many degrees are there in minor arc AB? And how many degrees are there in major arc APB?
A right angle contains 90 degrees. Therefore, the minor arc contains 90 degrees. Since the total number of degrees all the way around the circle is 360, the major arc APB has 360 minus 90, which equals 270 degrees.
What if the central angle is a straight angle with 180 degrees? Then the minor arc contains 180 degrees, and the major arc contains 360 minus 180, which is also 180 degrees. We call an arc with 180 degrees a semicircle.
In that case, that central angle, AOB, lies on a diameter of the circle. Remember that a diameter is a line segment that connects two points on a circle and that passes through the center. A diameter cuts a circle into two semicircles. Angle ABC in this figure has its vertex upon the circle. The angle sides are chords of the circle. This angle is called an inscribed angle in a circle.
The following theorem gives a method to find the measure of an inscribed angle. The measure of an inscribed angle is equal to one half of the measure of its intercepted arc.
Let us explain what that means by giving some examples. Look at angle ABC. It cuts off the arc AC, a semicircle. Arc AC measures 180 degrees. Therefore, angle ABC measures one half of 180 degrees. Angle ABC must therefore measure 90 degrees, which is a right angle.
In the following example, arc AC is given to have measure 60 degrees. Can you figure out the measure of angle ABC?
Angle ABC is an inscribed angle. Its measure is one half of the measure of the intercepted arc of 60 degrees. The angle therefore contains 30 degrees.
In this example, we are told that angle AOB contains 50 degrees. What is the measure of angle ACB?
Since the central angle, AOB, contains 50 degrees, we conclude that the minor arc, AB, is also of measure 50 degrees. Since the inscribed angle, ACB, intercepts an arc of 50 degrees, the inscribed angle, ACB, must measure half of 50, or 25 degrees. In our final example about inscribed angles, suppose that we are given triangle ABC that is inscribed in a circle. And suppose that we know that the measures of arcs AB, BC, and CA are in the proportion 5 to 4 to 1. Find each of the angles of the triangle.
Let the number of degrees in arc CA equal x. Then the measure of arc AB equals 5x, and the measure of arc BC equals 4x. The entire circle contains 360 degrees, so the sum of the three arcs equals 5x plus 4x plus x, which equals 360. Solving for x, we have 10x equals 360. X equals 36. Therefore, arc CA measures 36 degrees, arc AB measures 5 times 36, which equals 180 degrees, and arc BC measures 4 times 36, which equals 144 degrees.
So far, we have learned how to find the measure of the central angle of a circle and of an inscribed angle. Now we continue with some other angles that are related to circles.
When two chords intersect in the interior of a circle, we can find the measures of the angles that they form. That angle is equal to one-half of the sum of the measures of the two intersected arcs.
Here's an example. Given that arc AB is of measure 60 degrees and arc CD is of measure 80 degrees, notice that angle CED and angle AEB are vertical angles and are therefore equal to each other. What is the measure of these angles?
We take one-half of the measures of the intersected arcs AB and CD. That gives us one-half of 60 plus 80, which is one-half of 140, giving us the answer of 70 degrees.
Our next case is where the vertex of an angle is exterior to the circle and the angle's sides intersect arcs on the circle. That can happen in several ways.
First, we can have this picture. The lines PAB and PCD form an angle outside of the circle at point P. Each of the lines PAB and PCD is a secant, intersecting the circle at two points.
Here's another way in which we can have this kind of angle. In this picture, PA and PC are each tangent to the circle. Each of the lines intersects the circle at exactly one point.
A third way in which we can have this kind of angle is shown in this picture. Angle P is formed by tangent PC and secant PAB.
The formula for the measure of the angle is the same for each of the three pictures that we described. The measure of the angle is equal to the difference of the measures of the intercepted arcs.
In the following example, we are given that the arc AC is of measure 30 degrees and arc BD is of measure 120 degrees. What is the measure of angle P?
We take one-half of the difference between 120 and 30. That equals one-half of 90, giving us the answer of 45 degrees.
Okay, now we know how to find the measure of an angle whose vertex is in the interior of a circle, and of an angle whose vertex is exterior to a circle. What about an angle formed by a chord and a tangent, whose vertex is right upon the circle?
This angle ABC is formed by the chord AB and the tangent BC. The measure of this angle equals one-half of the intercepted arc.
For example, suppose that arc AB contains 100 degrees. We can conclude that angle ABC measures half of 100, giving us 50 degrees.
Now, let us review and summarize all of the angles that we have learned about that are associated with circles.
A central angle has its vertex at the center of the circle. It has the same measure as the intercepted arc.
An inscribed angle has its vertex upon the circle. It has one half of the measure of the intercepted arc.
An angle formed by two chords that intersect inside a circle has the measure of one half of the sum of the intercepted arcs.
An angle whose vertex is in the exterior of a circle has the measure of 1/2 of the difference of the intercepted arcs.
And an angle whose vertex is upon the circle that is formed by a chord and a tangent has measure that is equal to 1/2 of the measure of the intercepted arc. Note that this result is the same as the result for an inscribed angle. In both cases, the vertex is on the circle, and in both cases, the measure of the angle equals 1/2 the measure of the intercepted arc.
Here are two more words to include in your vocabulary. A square whose vertices are upon the circle is said to be inscribed in the circle. We then say that the circle circumscribes the square.
The square that is on the outside of our circle circumscribes the circle. The circle is inscribed in the square. The sides of the square are tangent to the circle. The inscribed figure is inside, and the circumscribed figure is outside.
We now want to talk about the area contained inside a circle. Inside of a circle whose radius is 5, about how much area do you think there is?
Well, we can figure out exactly the area inside of the square that circumscribes the circle. That square is 10 by 10, so its area is 100.
Another way of looking at it is by thinking about the four little 5 by 5 squares that make up the big square. The side of each of those little squares is the radius of the circle. So the area of each little square is the radius squared, which is 25. The area of the big square is 4 times the radius squared, again giving us 100.
We can see that the area of the circle is less than that. It is less than 4 times the radius squared. In fact, it is just a little bit more than 3 times the radius squared.
The formula that you should know for finding the area of a circle is area equals pi r squared. Pi is a Greek letter that we use to represent the number that is a little bit more than 3. An interesting thing about pi is that it is impossible to express pi exactly as a fraction or as a decimal with a finite number of decimal places. It is more than 3. It is actually closer to 3 1/7.
If you want a closer approximation, we can say that it is about 3.1415965358979323846. But even that is not exact. Pi is an example of an irrational number. The word irrational does not mean insane or anything like that. An irrational number is one that we cannot express as a ratio or as a fraction.
Here is an example of applying the formula for the area of a circle. What is the area of a circle whose radius equals 7?
The formula is pi times r squared. Using 22/7 as an approximation for pi, we have 22/7 times 7 times 7. The 7's cancel, so we have 22 times 7, which equals 154 square units. If we had used 3.14 as the approximation for pi, we would have 3.14 times 7 times 7, which equals 153.86 square units.
As you have seen, we use pi in the formula to find the area of a circle. There is another important formula about circles that uses pi. That is the formula to find the circumference of a circle.
Circumference means the distance all around a circle. It corresponds to the word perimeter that we used when we talked about polygons.
The formula for the circumference of a circle is pi times the diameter. Ultimately, remembering that the diameter is 2 times the radius, we can say that the circumference equals pi times 2r, or in other words, 2 pi r.
Let us find the circumference of the first circle that we talked about. Its radius was equal to 5, and its diameter was equal to 10. So its circumference is pi times d. Using 3.14 as the approximation for pi, we have 3.14 times 10, which equals 31.4.
Now, here's an exercise for you about circumferences. What is the circumference of the circle whose radius equals 7?
circumference equals 2 pi times r. Using 3.14 for pi, we have 2 times 3.14 times 7, which equals 47.6.
To review, we have learned two formulas about circles. The area equals pi r squared, and the circumference equals 2 pi r. Notice that in the area we have the radius squared, and the area is measured in square units. In circumference, the radius is not squared. The units for the circumference are the same as the units for the radius. These two formulas are important. You must understand these formulas and remember them. We have so far discussed the area and circumference of an entire circle. We will now talk about area and the arc length of portions of a circle.
The region within a circle that is bounded by two radii and an arc is called a sector of the circle. The formulas for the area and circumference of an entire circle can be applied to sectors by using the measure of the sector's arc.
Remember, those formulas were A equals pi r squared and C equals 2 pi r. Those formulas apply to the area and circumference all of the way around the circle for all 360 degrees.
Consider the circle with radius 7, which we talked about before. We found its area to be approximately 154 square units. Suppose we are asked the area of sector AOB, where angle AOB contains 90 degrees. The arc AB is also of measure 90 degrees.
The entire circle has 360 degrees, so our sector has 90 divided by 360, or 1/4 of the area. 1/4 of 154 equals 38.5 square units, which is the area of that sector.
We found the circumference of the entire circle to equal about 47.6 units, so the length of the minor arc AB is 1/4 of 47.6, which equals 11.9 units.
The example that we just did can be generalized to sectors and arcs of any measure. To find the area of any sector, find out what proportion of the entire area is in that sector. If the measure of the arc is m degrees and the entire circle is 360 degrees, then divide m by 360 to find the proportion of the circle's area that is in this sector. That gives us the formula that the area of the sector equals m over 360 times pi r squared.
Similarly, the length of the arc is m over 360 times the circumference of the entire circle, which is m over 360 times 2 pi r.
In our next example, we will combine some of the material we just learned with some material that we learned about triangles in a previous tape. Let us again consider the circle of radius 7 and the sector AOB, where arc AB is of measure 90 degrees. We draw the straight line between A and B in our circle. Remember, we call that line AB a chord. We want to find the area between the chord AB and the arc AB. We found the area of the sector to be 38.5 square units. We need to subtract the area of the triangle AOB. The area of a triangle is 1/2 of the length of the base times the height. In this case, the base and the height both measure 7. So the area of the triangle equals 1/2 of 7 times 7, which equals 24.5 square units. The area that we are looking for is 38.5 minus 24.5, which equals 14 square units.
The region bounded by a chord and the arc of a circle is called a segment of a circle. In the example that we just completed, we found the area of our segment. We found the area of the segment by subtracting the area of a triangle from the area of a sector.
In this fifth tape of Math Made Easy Geometry, we have presented a great deal of important information about circles. You learned about the lines associated with circles, the radius, diameter, chords, secants, and tangents. And you learned about the angles formed by these lines. Finally, you learned to compute areas and circumferences.
Remember to practice all the skills you've learned and review the tapes whenever you need to refresh your knowledge. I'm Alan Roberts, thanking you for working along with us.
And I'm Vanessa Stewart, saying goodbye for now and wishing you continued success in all your studies. This concludes the Math Made Easy series on plane geometry. I hope that you enjoyed it and that you learned a lot.